Praise God. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the power and the presence of your word. Thank you, Lord, that your word is like a two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit. And we thank you, Father, that your word is spirit and they are life. They just do not just contain knowledge or wisdom, but your word contains your life. And we ask, O God, that as we consider your word, that you establish your word afresh into our lives. Open again, O God, the eyes of our understanding, that we may know, that we may discern all that is in your word, and that we may establish ourselves upon your word. For heaven and earth will pass away, but your word will not pass away. Father, we thank you, Lord, that the name of Jesus continues to be glorified through your word. And we thank you, Lord, for those who are touched, those who are healed, those who are blessed, those who are transformed by your word. Thank you, Father God, that you continue to establish your presence in our midst, and that we will all bow down to your word. Let your word, Lord, be supreme, for your word is yea and amen. And every promise in your word is yea and amen. And we thank you, Father God, that all our lives are established around your word. Indeed, O Lord, you said through Jesus, if you love me, you will love my word. And your words, Lord, allow it, Lord, to abide in our hearts afresh as we sit in your presence. That as you abide in us and your words abide in us, we will bear much fruit. And that fruit will remain. We thank you, Father, for establishing your word in our midst. Glorify and reveal Jesus afresh to us. Cause our eyes to be upon Jesus, O God, that we may see him and know him afresh. We may know his presence. We may know all of the amazing wonders of his grace to us. Teach us thy word as we sit at the feet of Jesus. We lift Jesus high in our midst, O Lord. And for all that you do, we covenant to give you the glory, the worship, and the honor. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Praise God. We are on a series on balanced prosperity. And we've been touching on spiritual principles. And sometimes we will touch on methodologies that are involved too. So let's look at the book of Proverbs, chapter 18, verse 16, the text of which we are taking on today. And of course, this teaching applies both to the business world and the ministry world. And let's look at Proverbs, chapter 18, verse 16. We'll lay down some foundational principles too. It says here, a man's gift makes room for him and brings him before great men. A man's gift makes room for him and brings him before great men. And before we look into all the various aspects that we can teach on, we will show forth, if possible, the notes that we have for this teaching series. And I know, and I heard some teaching on this aspect, and I heard one particularly wrong teaching that somebody says, and some people interpret as a man's gift makes room for him. And I heard one American preacher says that that it referred to a giving of a bribe. I don't think so. You might have heard that teaching before. I say no, that's not right. And God cannot be violating his word. Bribes are wrong. And they're against the ethical standards of the Bible. And so people misinterpret the word because they don't look at the original language. And so there is a purpose and a reason why we look into the Hebrew or the Greek. Because without that, you're depending on somebody else's interpretation or translation. And you cannot get further than the original language. And so to establish us on sound ground, the word give is from the word matan, as some people pronounce it. And it means present a gift or a reward. But nowhere does it apply a bribe at all. It's a gift or a reward. And that's the original word, matan, that is there. And the other word that we want to look at is the word room, which is a word rakab. And that's from the word to broaden, to enlarge, to make large unto us. And I've given a bit extra there on the BDB definition there. And that's to be or to grow wide, grow large, to widen and large. All is Hebrew usage, like a roomy pasture, and all its various form. And so that's what it means to make room. In other words, a person's gifting will be able to create the room or the business or the opportunity or the ministry for the person to function. That's what the word broaden means. And we go on to the next one. And that's covering the word and brings him. The word brings is the word neka. And why we want the word neka to be mentioned? Because we're interested in how it brings the person a step further. Brings him before great men. And the word brings implies to transport, to bestow, to guide, to govern, to lead. And so many aspects of bringing a person to the place or position that God has for the person. Now, it's an interesting little word. And in the BDB definition that we have for you, is to lead, to guide. The word guide seems to be its root meaning. So we have here, a man's gift will make room or broaden the path for himself, for him, and will actually guide him. The gift will actually guide you and bring you into the next aspect or the place where God wants us to be. And there's some of that on the last part. And I need to examine the word great and what it means. Because people will ask, what do you mean by great man? Why should the gift bring us before great men? And who are these great men? So we have the Hebrew definition also for you, for great, which is gadol. Gadol sounds like an Indonesian dish, right? Quite nice too. The Indonesian roja is gado-gado, right? Something like that. And here, gado-gadol. And so we have here great in the sense of being older. Older than you, and elder or exceedingly or greater, higher, more mighty, more noble. Because there's a negative aspect of proud in gadol. But it has aspect of people who are more experienced than you. People who are higher in society than you. In ministry, it means to bring you before people who are more experienced than you in ministry. And as you know, no ministry is established by themselves. Every one of us always stands on the shoulders of those before us. And so that also goes in terms of business. For example, the first person who invented a car, that's very tough. After it's invented, you can reverse technology and reinvent it and then make it better. And once somebody has done it, it's easier to copy than it is to think about it in the first place. So that's why it's important to learn from the best. And it says a man's gift will make room for him and will bring you before those who are more experienced than you, those mightier, more those who are older or whatever, or noble. It could be positioned in society. And then we have the little bit there here on the word gadol in its different usage there. And it can be in a sense of, in the term of the word great, it can also be in a sense of more advanced, excellent, and that is, one is more excellent than you. one who does a better job than you, and then you can learn from them. Your gift will bring you to the place. So there are other side meanings that we have here, and to lift up, as you can see there. Let's look at the next one on the other definitions. Look at all the various usage of the word gadol in the Hebrew. Gadol has been used in adjective form. Gadol is a word great man. Gadol. And so here, gadol by itself has been used to refer to large in number, in intensity, loud in sound, older in age, in importance, more distinguished of God Himself, great things, haughty things, greatness, etc. So you can see all the various usages of the word gadol. And having a look at that in verse 16, and emphasize the word, a man's gift makes room for him and brings him before great men. First, we want to define what that gifting is. That gifting can be a natural talent that comes from God, or a spiritual gift that comes from God. It is still a gift. It is God who gives us abilities of our soul, abilities of our nature, talents that He has given unto us. And on top of that, when we come to know Jesus and are filled with the Holy Spirit, God drops His spiritual gifts upon us. So all of us do have talents that are part of our lives that we are born with, and we all have gifts too. One of the things we all realize about talents, and we are learning about spiritual giftings, is that talents can still be developed. You might be talented in music. That doesn't excuse you from taking music lessons. That doesn't excuse you from practicing. That doesn't excuse you from learning from others. The talent just enables you to learn faster, to go beyond what you're taught, to be able to make possibly a unique career or gifting out of that talent that you have. But it doesn't excuse us from learning, from training, and all those things. We understand in the area of talent. We all start with the ABCs. Sometimes people think about spiritual giftings in the same way. They think that when God gives us a gift, whether it be tongues, it be healing, or it be word of knowledge, or any gifts, that we expect to operate it instantly in that manner. That doesn't come that way either. The gift can come from God, but the other saying of practice makes perfect, we still need to learn to inculcate it into our life and to exercise the gifts. Which is why passages like Romans chapter 12 tells us that whatever the gifts the Holy Spirit has given to us, those from ministering on ministering, prophecy on prophesying, and teaching on teaching, and giving on giving. So with diligence. So even though the gifting is there, we need to exercise it in order for us to be good in operating that gift. Of course, it would be wonderful if we could learn it from somebody else, because sometimes there's nothing better than practical training. Theoretical training is a different thing. But practical training, it covers areas that sometimes you do not see at all. And for example, we talk about healing. Until, I believe, Charles and Francis Hunter, who has gone to be with the Lord, did a practical session on healing. Most people who are praying for backaches and all that, are people growing their legs long or their hands long and short. Many people say, okay, let's pray, and that's it. But when they came, they not only thought about praying for legs to be lengthened or shortened, but they also show practical areas that are not covered, sometimes in the theory. Like, for example, in general, there is at least a certain percentage of people, and perhaps your sitting position, perhaps through a habit that is formed, and the alignment of your body, there is always a percentage of people in any crowd who have legs that are slightly
longer, one shorter than the other. Hands that are slightly shorter than the other. And then there is a technique that has been developed for people to be healed of those things. And they're easily prayed for. And you can pass on the techniques, but remember behind it is a principle. It's a principle. And if you're here and you have a bit of space, let's all just stand up for a moment and just to demonstrate this type of things. and if you got enough space around you, you don't have enough space, you can go to the aisle, you knock somebody in front. And some of the techniques that they gave, for example, in examining yourselves, is when you stand with both your feet facing the front together, of course it's uncomfortable for you, then of course you need healing of your back. And then you just relax your hand, and then you bring your hand out, and then without any stretching or strain, you bring it right in front of you, right in the front, and put your hand together, facing together, and then hold that position, and you bring it to you, and you see whether one is longer than the other. Now, anybody here got one slightly longer than the other? If you want to redo it, fine, just redo it again. Yeah. Anybody here one slightly longer than the other? Okay, would you come forward if yours is exceptional? Of course, if you're 6 inches, then quickly come up. If yours is 1 mm also, and you just want to come up, that's fine. But if there's a substantial difference, then you come up right now. Yeah. Anybody else? Yeah. And remember, your leg needs to be reasonable, and you can come. Right. I explained the theory also. Yeah, okay. It's different, eh? Quite a large difference. You did it a few times and it's still the same. One longer than the other. Then we need to pray for you. Definitely. We need to pray. Okay. Praise God. I said two. So we got two out of this crowd. Well, the rest of you, good health. Live long and prosper. God bless you. All right, anyway. All right. Anybody else? Anybody else? Yes, 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 yes. Just come out. Praise God. Now, the rest of you may be seated while these are here. So you guys are here? A little bit. Okay. Now, your feet need to be standing together. Touching. Your toes need to be touching together. You see, these are all little things you cannot teach in a healing meeting. Right. So, some people, when they stand, they might stand, Right. So, or they stand, Or they stand like clowns. Right. No. You put in these little things, which are things that you can teach in a book on healing, but when you train someone, there are a lot of areas not covered. How do you put in a book? Stand, facing, unless you draw a picture. Okay, the feet need to be slightly together. On that part, yeah, slightly together. Thank you. And then you need to be very relaxed at the back. And then let your hand just swing freely. Thank you. And then as your hand swing freely, then you bring your hands to the front and hold it there for a moment. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. All right, slightly, yours is slightly. Oh, yours is a lot. That's right. Okay, everybody stretch forth their hands towards them. We keep your position. We're going to pray for you right now. And as we pray, you sense something happening to your back and adjustments right now. We thank you, Father God. In the name of Jesus, we command in the name of Jesus. And we command the left and the right upper area of the hand, the upper backbone, to be shifted into position. And we command both hands to be stretched forth by the power of your Holy Spirit. And we command in Jesus' name for both hands to be stretched perfectly aligned. In Jesus' name, we thank you. There it comes forth. And there it's come forth. Stretching forth in Jesus' name. Stretching forth. Thank you, Father God, stretching forth in Jesus' name. Now, you find some adjustment happening right now, and everybody stretch forth your hands towards them and pray in the Spirit as the Lord adjusts it in them. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, Lord, thank you for the upper backbone that's being touched. That's it right now. Can you say, oh, it's moving forward. A little bit more, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. little bit more. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, for stretching the upper backbone in Jesus' name. There's power going right now through your upper backbone. Thank you, Father. Stretch your right hand. Stretch the right hand, Father, in Jesus' name. Adjust it right now. We thank you, Father, for your adjustment. Adjustment, Lord, right now in Jesus' name. A little bit more, Father God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Wonderful. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, wonderful. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise God. In Jesus' name, seal your work of healing into these bodies. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen. You can bring your hand towards that. Yours was the most prominent. Do you feel an adjustment going on in the back when your prayer is made? Yeah. But your hand, you can put it again. Yeah. Okay. Much better than before. Hey? Yeah. Quite a difference. Yeah. Yours, I noticed, I was measuring this one versus this one. Yeah. So this one was slightly longer, but this one was the same length. Yeah. I was looking at the middle one. Yes. And that's the same now, your middle section. Yeah, almost. Praise God. Amen. Thank you very much. Amen. God bless you. Amen. Now, that's just like operating the gift of healing. Now, in terms of operating the gift of healing, there are techniques that you cannot train except in a practical session. Which is why you're talking about operating a gift. Or what about... long ago, before people started businesses and business schools, people used to have mentoring and apprentice system. People learn their trades. One who wanted to be a plumber would sit under a plumber for some time. One who wanted to be skillful in whatever carpentry, they would work under a carpentry. Now today, some specialized trades are that way still. And they got to sit under the master, sometimes for years. Because there are things that you cannot put into line upon line, precept upon precept, and they are practical things that you can't teach. And that is why the Bible also is in that way. It talks about discipleship. And it says, a man's gift, your gift, will make room for you. What is that gift? How does the gift make room for us? The gift makes room for us because that gift has been developed, it has been trained. It's not in reference to a gifting that just comes and then straight away makes room for you. We realize that every gift has a time of training. And Proverbs 18 verse 16 can be also read alongside Proverbs chapter 22, verse 29, the last verse. Because the ending is about the same. I say it's more specific. In Proverbs 22, verse 29, it says, "Do you see a man who excels in his work? He will stand before kings." Now, kings are great men, all right, in terms of dignitary, or they're higher than you. He will not stand before unknown or those who are like insignificant. Now that looks almost similar, except instead of emphasizing the gift, it emphasizes the man's excellence. A man who excels in his work. The word excel is the Hebrew word mahei, which speaks about three things. Being quick, being prompt, and being diligent. Being quick, being prompt, being diligent. If you do something and you're good at it, you would do it better than everyone else, and you could possibly also do faster than everyone else. Now, I realize that there are some things that really take time to do. But to do the same level as another person, you would probably take less time. But because you're going at a higher level, you might take a longer time because of the detail work or whatever, the gifting that God has. Now, the only difference between the two verses is that one emphasizes on the person doing something, excel, or the Hebrew word maher. The other emphasizes on gift. But the end result is it brings you before kings, before great men. The end result is the same. Why are those verses placed together? How does that relate to unbalanced or balanced prosperity in God? In ministry, in life, we realize that who we are and what we do are closely related. If you do something from who you are, there is no strain. If you love music and you do music, there is no strain. Because you are by nature musical. If you are by nature, for example, intellectual, then you will probably love logic and it's not a strain to you. Who we are and what we do are closely connected. Who we are is established also by God. We are the workmanship of God. It is God who makes us who we are. And every single one of us here in this place, and every single one of us who is listening to this word, has talents and gifts in our life. Whether it be a talent and gift that God established us to function in the corporate world or secular world, professional world, or be it be a gift or talent to function in a ministry world, we all have that. If there are no talents and gifts, they are also the opposite of the words, Proverbs 18:16, there is no room for us. There's no room for us. Now, if the gift makes room for you, no gift means no room. Thus, in order for us to find our place in society, find our place in this life, find our place in the ministry, we need to find ourselves. Before you talk about functioning in a ministry, functioning with a corporate body, functioning in the corporate world, we need to find ourselves. Who are we? What are we good at? No one will be good at everything. And I emphasize again, in this ministry, we do not encourage people to copy one another. We encourage people to discover their gifts and their talent. And we can train and we can disciple based on standard principles from the Bible, but everyone will come out differently. There's no like factory mold that we make everybody in the same image. The only image is Christ, and He's so multifaceted that He creates different lights and different giftings in each one of us. Let's look at one Bible example first, and then we will illustrate. For example, let's look at the life of Joseph. Joseph has talent and he has gifting. In the book of Genesis, we know that Joseph demonstrated when he was in Egypt, in the book of Genesis, chapter 39. When he started as a slave, sold as a slave to Egypt, Bible tells us in verse 2, Genesis 39 verse 2, the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all he did to prosper in his hand. I emphasize again, it was what he did. A lot of people want God to prosper them, but they don't do anything. Whether it be ministry or in the professional or business world, God prosper the work of our hands. If our hands do no work, there is nothing for God to prosper. God doesn't bless lazy people. Whether in the ministry or in the professional world, hard work is essential to be a part of God prospering us. Learning the grace message, we realize that the hard work is not done by trying to be, but by working out from who we are. So on the one hand, we emphasize hard work. But hard work alone cannot bring you to where you want to be. We need to be balanced here. Hard work is important. Working hard is a principle. Being diligent. The word in Proverbs 22, verse 29, it includes hard work, being diligent about what we do. But we all know in this life, working hard alone sometimes doesn't bring anyone where they should. Because sometimes a person works very hard, and at the end of it, they don't see much fruit from their labor. So there must be something more than hard work. In Catherine Kuhlman's book, where written by Jamie Buckingham and the daughter Destiny, she has one little sermon on hard work, and she is a hard worker in the ministry. But she also realized she has been taught by her father to work hard. And she says, Papa always tell her to work hard, and she works hard. And then as she's talking about her ministry, she realized that just working hard wouldn't have brought her there. It took the gifting of God. So on the one hand is hard work. On the other hand is the grace of God. Because what was the opposite of works? Grace. And we know that the grace of God, there is still hard work. Except that this time, the hard work is energized from the grace of God inside you. It doesn't remove the hard work. It only removes the blood, sweat, and tears and toil of the hard work. You don't feel it as much. Because Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15 verse 10, it is not I, but the grace of God within me. In fact, he said, I labor more abundantly, but it's not I, but the grace of God laboring more abundantly. So there's an extra source of energy that is supplied called the grace of God. Now this grace of God is what is inside us, is the talents and the gift. It did not say in Proverbs 18:16, hard work makes room for you. It says your gift makes room for you. But involved in growing your gift is, of course, hard work. In a sense of yielding and doing a lot of it. God blesses the work of our hands. Joseph worked hard and he saw what he did. God prospered what he did. He found favor in verse 4. Joseph found favor in his sight, served him. Then he made him overseer of his house and put everything under his authority. From that verse, I could gather these are the talents of Joseph. He was a very diligent person. When he does something, he must have done it quick and diligent. You know how some people, when you ask them to do something, they take their time and it never gets done. But when he says, Joseph, Joseph gets it done. And when Potiphar needs something else, Joseph, he knows Joseph will get it done. If you get any other slave, they might take their time and get it half done. So there was diligence. These are all his talents. There was also administrative skill. He was an overseer. And he was a good overseer. He was able to manage people. Obviously, Potiphar has more than one slave. He's a rich, powerful man. And in those days, slaves might be very cheap. So he might own many slaves. And by the time he brought Joseph, slaves already existed. Joseph worked his way up. Joseph was diligent. Joseph was a good administrator. And Joseph managed people. He managed people, but how do I know that? Because when he was thrown into prison, Only someone who care and is a personable person will notice when the prisoners you're in charge of are sad. Only a good personnel manager will notice when the employees are sad, when they are depressed, when they are down. Joseph noticed two new prisoners, the butler and the baker, and they were very sad. It was none of his business, but his PR ability came up. These are all his talents. His talent made room for him. His talent brought him higher and higher into a position of authority until he was number one in Potiphar's house. When he was in prison, he became number one in the prison, in charge of all the prisoners, so that whatever was done by him. Even the jailkeeper doesn't know what goes on in the prison. Say, you know what's going on in prison? I don't know. Ask Joseph. Who is Joseph? Oh, he is also a prisoner. Joseph, his gift made room for him. Even in prison, it made room for you. Look at that. It is your gift that makes room anywhere in the world. If you're gifted in the Lord and your gift has been sharpened and is functional, you know, you can have gifts that are dysfunctional or not functioning yet, which is different from being dysfunctional. Then, of course, it's not going to make room for us. That's why Proverbs 18:16, go to with Proverbs 22, verse 29, where it is sharpened. And all these talents brought him to the place where he actually has another gift on top of that. That is a spiritual gift. The gift of interpretation of dreams. No one knows exactly when it started, but since he was a dreamer of dreams, even when he was at the age of 17, possibly he was someone who sought to know about dreams. And through all the years, he has sharpened his ability to interpret dreams. Until by the time he stood in the prison, when, I mean, you cannot open any shop, say, interpreting dream. Who want to interpret dream? But prisoners, you know, sometimes we read the Bible story, we forgot there's a lot of many years that's taking place. Do you think that the butler and baker's dreams were the first dreams Joseph interpreted? No. Has anyone here been to prison before? I hope not, but if some of you are, you know, God bless you that, you know, you've gone through, you pay your dues, and we're glad to have you. But in prison, there's not much to do. I mean, after a certain time, you get locked up again. And there's work to do. What do you do when you don't have much to do? You talk. Chat. Maybe you got a prison mate. Or wherever, you got free time. Well, shoot, every day is the same schedule. Slightly different prisoner food. A great opportunity to talk about dreams. I suspect Joseph developed his ability in dreams, sharpened it by interpreting on it, because prisoners do dreams. Say, hey, what dream you had yesterday? Okay, what is this dream? What that? They're talking about dreams all the time. And Joseph must be known to be interpreting dreams. And I remember when I was in those days preaching in the Korean church, and we went to a Korean camp and we preached a normal passage. Then we had question and answer. During the question and answer, people start asking about dreams. Suddenly, there's a whole long line of people asking interpretation for dreams because they realize that their dreams could be interpreted. I suspect those things could be happening in prison. So when they discover, oh, Joseph can interpret dream. Hey, the other day I had this dream, what do you mean? Maybe some of his dreams even come to pass. Where he might have told them, okay, in 18 days you'll be out. And they were out. You never know. And so suddenly he has two more dreams, the butler and the baker. and he interpreted, and it came to pass exactly as it is. And everyone knows he has a reputation to interpret dream. That was another gift on top of his talent. He has talents and he has gifts. Now, the word matan, give, cover both talents and gifts. Because your talent is originally a general, natural gift from God too. So, your talent and your gift. And then there was a special gifting or interpretation of dreams. Can you imagine? Pharaoh had a dream that no one could interpret. And the butler remembered Joseph. At that time, when you're called to interpret dreams before Pharaoh, you got no room for error. No room for error. Because if you make a mistake, that will also be your last mistake. No room for error. You better be very good at interpreting dreams. And you got to make sure that your dream is real. I mean, people are very clever, you know, they can tell stories from dreams. I heard people interpret dreams and they're all, a lot of them are all way out. And, but when it comes to Pharaoh, it better be real. It better be true. Because if it does not, end of your life. It was important that the gift took time to develop. And you think about Joseph. What made him who he was? His gift made room for him. He started as a slave, and his talents made room for him. And then later, his gift make room for him. His spiritual gifts make room for him. His natural talents, gifts make room for him. And then there was others, until he rose to the highest point. A great example of your gift makes room for you. Daniel is the same way. Daniel rose up to be the main person in charge of an entire empire under the king. Same story in the book of Daniel. He started as a slave, a captive, which is equal to a slave. He owned nothing. He'd be enslaved, captured. But from day one, he started to please God. He's diligent in God. And he learned to pray to get results. And the Bible tells us that God gave him the gift of interpretation of dreams. But we realize something else that Daniel was good at. He was a man of prayer. He learned to pray through. Slightly different from Joseph. And in the book of Daniel, if you have a quick look, in Daniel's life, in verse 17, these four young men, God gave them knowledge and skill in all literature and wisdom. That means Daniel had those things too, but Daniel had something more. Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. And don't forget, this is also a natural test. So you can see so many talents. They were talented in studies, talented in history, talented in literature, and skillful in many areas. The details are not listed here. But when they were brought before the king, he interviewed them in verse 19. The king interviewed them. Don't forget, these are not the only people he interviewed. He interviewed hundreds of others. But these four young men stood higher than anyone else. And in verse 20, in all matters of wisdom and understanding about which the king examined them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers in his realm. I could imagine the king asked them, okay, tell me about the stars. And they will go, va, 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 va. Okay, Tell me about this literature, the Chaldean, everything they knew. They were talented. They were very talented. God gave it to them. See, God is the one who does give natural gifts. In fact, if you are studying, or you're a student, or you're a senior, going back to studies, God can give you knowledge and skill in literature. In all areas of knowledge, when you ask for that, God is the one who can give it to us. And God did. The talent rose 10 times better than all the world. That was not the only talent that Daniel had. Daniel had the ability to pray true in God. Because they were already among the wise men, don't forget. And one day the king had a dream, and he forgot the dream. And he asked for something impossible. Tell me both the dream and the interpretation. That is more difficult than just interpreting the dream. And so even the magician says, no one has asked such a thing. And the king says, you don't know, you die. And in fact, they say it was 11. It is difficult. It's a difficult thing. He says, only the gods would know how to have this thing. In verse 12, the king was very angry. He was a very bad-tempered king. Imagine serving a bad-tempered king. The king was angry, very furious, and gave command, destroy all the wise men. And that included Daniel, actually, and his three friends. And as the command went out in verse 13, they began killing. People were already dying. Wise men were having their heads chopped off. And they came to Daniel to arrest and kill him. And as they came to arrest Daniel, Daniel, with counsel and wisdom, in verse 14. How do you talk to someone sent to execute you? You have to have great PR skills. Remember, the guy came to chop off his head. How do you talk to the person? Oh, be very rude to him. I am Daniel. Definitely PR skills. And let me say this again. Whether in the ministry or in the corporate world or in the professional world, if you don't have PR skills, you can never work as a team. You can never be a leader. What does a good leader do? He inspires people. He leads without people knowing he leads. Many people want to copy military command leadership. Military command leadership, although the Bible has illustrations in that, is not the style of heaven or Jesus. Has Jesus ever commanded his disciples in that manner? Give me scripture and verse. No. Although I do believe in discipline to a certain extent, like David and his mighty man, there was a lot of discipline. Because sometimes people who are undisciplined need to be disciplined. Some people need it hard, some people need it soft. But overall, even among military personnel, you'll find they still need PR. Because at some point they got to relate to human beings and to people. And if you're married as a military man, you cannot march home to your house, open the door, and your whole family, from your wife to all your three or four children, all standing at attention. And then you say, Edis! And then you say, okay, my dinner cooked? Yes, right, attend to that. You didn't done your homework? No, sir! Yes, sir! No, sir! You try running your family like that, no more relationship. You can't. So life is a balance. It's a balance of all things and all principles. Now, some people thrive on that. And any one of you who are parents, you have more than one child, you realize all your children got different personality. There's no such thing as one size fits all. You ever try one size fits all? Usually it's one size fits none. For one person it's a bit too loose, one person is a bit too tight. But everybody just couldn't be bothered, just say okay, one size fits all. You never one size fits all. People are different sizes. I believe one of the most difficult things sometimes in life is handling people. Handling people. You know why? Especially 5-4 ministers. The more successful 5-4 are, the more ego they have. And egoistic. I can do it. I got this gift. I can do it. You know, it's very hard to handle. Or sometimes people who are successful in the world, they all come with big egos. Maybe you got 20 professional people who are each multi-millionaire in their own thing. Put all of them in one board together. I tell you, each one of them will be watching each other's ego, trying to see who gets the best recognition, etc. Too much ego around. When Jesus comes, he talks about being a servant of all, which you're going to touch on. Part of the training of any gifting is learning to be a servant. Servanthood. The kingdom of God is not like the kingdom of the world. Didn't Jesus say that? He said, do not be like the Gentiles. He says that in the gospel, don't be like the Gentiles. Don't do things the Gentile way. And so there we have in verse 14, they come to arrest Daniel. It says, with counsel and wisdom. In verse 14, with counsel or wisdom. Another gift and talent that Daniel had, he had management, people management skills. He knew how to talk to his executioner who had just come to arrest him. And he convinced him to give me more time. He convinced him and he said in verse 15, why is the king so urgent? You could put it this way, why is he so urgent to kill us? And Arioch made the decision known to him, and then Daniel went in and he asked the king to give him time. Don't know how much time, but he says, give me time and I will get the answer for you. That brought another of Daniel's gifting. Daniel was a team player. You know, in time of danger, many people will only save their own lives. Say, kill the rest, leave me alive. But Daniel wanted to save everyone. And he went in with his three friends, still a team player. He did not say, okay, I can do it alone. He went to his friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, and he got them all to pray together. You can see so many talents functioning. And these are the unwritten things where he learned to pray with these people. And this is one prayer meeting which is very powerful. Because if they don't get the answer to their prayer, the next day they die. You would love to be that kind of prayer meeting. Because you know that the next morning you're going to die if God never heard your prayer. Tell you, nobody fell asleep in there all night. Everybody is praying. Oh God, you know, praying. Oh God, oh God. You know, even at 3 a.m. they'll be counting. What, 6 a.m. you're going to die. They will be praying. More time, stretch the clock. And they prayed till they got the answer. And he had the answer. That brought another spiritual gifting of Daniel. He was a man who learned how to pray. When whatever problems, he goes on his knees. And you find it all the time. Later on, when he was an elderly man, serving another kingdom and empire that has taken over this one, that he was the first empire, that they found an accusation against him, Daniel went on his knees before God. He went on his knees and he still continued praying 3 times a day. And guess what happened to all his accusers? They all died, thrown to the lions. They wanted Daniel to die, but they themselves died. Because your gift makes room for you. When your gift makes room for you and people oppose the gift of God, what did God say? You're opposing God. Especially when the gift flows from God. Now, I know men of God take it wrongly sometimes. And some men of God are so proud, they use it as something to oppress people. Don't touch the anointed. Meaning, I am the one. Right? In a proud way, which is not the way Jesus meant it to be. But while we make fun of that, at the same time, we also need to know there is a real side to it too. When it's really an anointing, then we also have to be very careful. Because we might be found going against God. Like Gamaliel. So every truth has been abused. But that doesn't remove the fact that a truth is still a truth. Your gift makes room for you. Your gift also protects you. And in terms of the gift making room for us, we establish these following principles. Principle number one. Faithful in little things will lead to faithful in more things. The gift doesn't just come overnight. Like that. It would be nice. Many people dream of being like Joseph. From prisoner to prime minister in one day. They forgot that he was probably about 17 years old and he was 30 years old when he stood before Pharaoh. 13 years of suffering. 13 years of preparation. 13 long years of rejection. 13 long years of trials and tests before his gift was developed. It took 13 years to prepare for the one day. When he turned from prisoner to prime minister in one day. Same with Daniel. Gone through all those things. And for that principle, faithful in little will be faithful in much. You can take it from Matthew 25, the parable of the talents. I won't read through all because most of you know the talents. I read the principle behind it. That when a person gave 5 talents to the one who had 5 talents, 2 talents to one, and then 1 talent to one. He gave in verse 15, Matthew 25 verse 15, to each according to his ability. So all of us got different giftings and different talents. We all must be faithful to the gifting and talent God gave to us. We cannot look at the other person and say, hey, I got only 1 talent, he got 5. I got 2, he got 1. We cannot look at one another. Each one of us have to look within ourselves and find your gift. Now, by gift, matan, include your talent. Don't worry about who you're going to be in the church. Don't worry about positions in the church. Don't worry about positions in the ministry. Don't worry about trying to make it in the ministry. Don't worry about trying to make it in the business world. Don't try to make it in the professional world. First and foremost, find out who you are. Who did God make you to be? Who you're born to be? Were you born to be a musician? Were you born to love mathematics? Become accountant. Were you born or professor of mathematics? Were you born to be a people person? Who are you? And a lot of people are not succeeding. They are trying to prosper here and prosper there when it is not where they are supposed to be. But if we find now, unfortunately, sometimes we wander around and we meander until we find who we are. Unfortunately, that is sometimes the pathway that God takes us. Sometimes He takes you on the road to Egypt like He did to Joseph. Sometimes He takes you on the road to Babylon and you look like you lost everything before you found yourself. Could Daniel have found himself in Israel? No. Could Joseph have found himself in Canaan? No. And don't even worry if sometimes you seem to be losing and losing and losing. Because what is happening is you're being stripped off. Joseph lost his coat of many colors that his father gave him. Joseph lost his loving family. Joseph lost, in a way, his brothers, especially Benjamin, whom he loved. Joseph lost his mother. Joseph lost his position of ease. He ended up with nothing. You know, it is when you are face to face with nothing but yourself that you discover who you really are. When you get rid of all your facade. In the time of the Holocaust, it must have been difficult for the Jews. But I read a little story of how when the Germans got all the Jews together, and remember, some of them are rich, mighty, high society and all that. You know what happened to them before they killed? Every one of them was forced to strip naked. Rich men, poor men, powerful men, old men, young men, women, girls, ladies, men, all stripped naked and much like cattle to a place where they were to be slaughtered. And in all their nakedness, some of them stood with dignity. They died with their dignity, intact, without bowing. Because they can take everything from you. They can take your money, they can take your position, they can take everything. But they cannot take who you are in God. Your dignity in God. And that's important for us to discover who we are. Sometimes it takes us to lose everything before we find who we are. But the faster you find it, the better. The slower you find your gifting, the slower things will move. To each is given our own ability. Don't look at someone else and try to be. Look within yourself, who you are. And let's admit it, sometimes you can't help being who you are. Some people will like you for who you are. Some people who hate you will hate you for who you are. But you can't help being who you are. It is who you are. They just have to accept you for who you are. But the most important person to accept who you are is you. Because if you don't accept who you are, you will never be happy with yourself. And what's important in this life? Money? No. Position? No. Friends? No. Good, but no. You know what's important in this life? Find joy and happiness. You can have all the money in the world, unhappy, no point. You get all the best position in the world, famous, not happy, no point. You know, deep inside, with each one of our heart, you know what we're all really looking for? We all really just want to be loved. We all just want love, peace, joy. I didn't use the word happiness because happiness is just outside, but really the true happiness from inside. We all actually just want a place of great love, great peace, great joy. Think about it. And why are some people trying to be rich, trying to get more and more money? Because they think by getting the money, they'll be happy. They'll find happiness. They find the peace they want. They find the joy they want. The pursuit of happiness. This reminds me of a little cartoon. Time for a cartoon break. I believe this story is from Obelix and Asterix. Was it from Obelix and Asterix? Could be. One of those. And they come across this lazy person. He's lying there. And they say, hey, why don't you work, you know? And then this lazy person says, why should I work? Oh, so that you can have money. He says, why do I have the money? So that you can have free time. Why do I want to have free time? So you can relax. And then this person say, I'm already relaxing. He went in a circle. So that's not exactly what we all want to be lazy. Person was just lazy. What we all really want is love, peace, and joy. Think about it. And do you know this? You can never really be happy until you're doing what you love. You can never really be happy until you do what you love. Which is why if God called you to the ministry, you cannot be happy until you're in the ministry. Which is why if God called you to be out in the professional world, the business world, you cannot be happy until you do something that you love. Now, I realize that this life throws us curveball. Some of us are in situations where you got no choice but to work very hard to earn a living, and the work that you got is just to put food on the table, and the practical way to put food on the table until you could have more time or you could find some way to make yourself happy. This is what I would suggest. If you're working hard to put food on the table and it's not really something that you love to do, if you need to study, then study. Do night classes. Do something that is in the dream, the vision that you want. Then keep doing that thing. Yes, you might have to work very hard for 16 hours a day at time, plus study and all those things, temporarily. But then you work so hard at it, then finally you got through your studies, and after you study, you graduate, then you could get another job. And with the other job, you're closer to your dream, closer to your vision, closer to something that you know you want to do in your life. So yes, all of us have times when we just have to take whatever comes to our hand so that you could put food on the table and you have clothes to wear and you can have food to eat. But that's not the ending. That's part of the journey. When Joseph was working as a slave, do you think that was his dream life? Oh, all my life, what is the ambition? To be a slave? No. God gave him a dream that one day he will be a ruler. But he worked hard as a slave. And slave work is not easy. Slave got no off day, no off time. And if you're a new slave, guess what? The worst job. He might be doing all the worst job possible, but he worked hard at it. And he worked his way up. Slowly he rose in his position until he became the number one slave who has slaves under him. He worked his way up. Faithful in little. God gave every one of them, the master gave everyone according to their ability. And then when the master came back in Matthew 25, it says here in verse 23, Well done, it says, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter the joy of the Lord. So that's the theme. Faithful in the few things, become faithful in the many. So the number one principle in developing our gift is whatever little opportunity we have, we function in it and we operate in it, you sharpen your gift. You sharpen your talent. If you love to play music, you play music. You sharpen in it. You develop in those areas. When I realized that God called me to the ministry, there were things that I chose to do. I read the Bible over and over again because I realized that you need the Bible. It takes homework, it takes time. I read it in many versions. But it is something that did not come by accident. I devoured the Bible because I knew if you want to preach and teach, you will need this. It was an important talent to develop. And that is called diligence. If you know that you are supposed to be a musician, you know what you do? Every day, be practicing your musical instrument. Faithful in little things. You don't wait until the big door open and then start practicing. While you're waiting for the door, you're sharpening your gift. Why? Your gift makes room for you. It is not the room makes the room makes room for your gift. That's how people interpret. You know, the room makes my gift. Never. Your gift makes room. Not the room makes your gift. But a lot of people just want room. They just want, give me a room, give me a room, give me a room. When the Lord says, what is your gift? What is your gift? What is your gift? Your gift makes room for you. And when there is no room, you still got your gift. You sharpen your gift. Polish your gift. All the time. If you're in a businessman, in a business world, there's so many aspects of business. And if there's a particular aspect of business that God calls you to be, and that's what you love to do, be an expert in that. Study all you can in that area. Ask God for wisdom. I've got to teach you knowledge and wisdom in that area. And it will involve studying, examining, to find the exact niche. And as you take diligence, God bless you. God will cause you to have knowledge in this area. It's important for us to develop the gift that God has for you. Faithful in little things, faithful in much. God will show us the way. The other area, don't forget the other part about bring you before great men, bring you before kings. So some of you ask, why is the second part important? See, Proverbs 18:16 got two parts. The first part is, your gift makes room for you. He didn't say, that's all. The second part tells you, it will bring you, transport you, lead you, guide you before great men. Why is the second part important? Because no one starts at the top. In any area of life, when you go in, we are all not Adam and Eve. We didn't start at the beginning. There's a whole civilization in front of you. In every place you go, somebody is already doing those things. Fresh young graduate from the Bible school, they come out, they want to do ministry, evangelize or pastor a church or plant a church. Somebody is already planting church. But it doesn't mean there's no room for others. There's still room. There's still room for fivefold evangelists. There's still room for evangelism. There's still room for hundreds of churches. There's still room. And you want to start a business? Somebody probably has the same business somewhere. But there's still room. There's always room. Your gift makes room even when there's no room. But the second part is important. Every one of us stand on the heads and shoulders of others. Mentoring and training positions and opportunities to learn from what was there before do not come to everyone. If, for example, my dream is to build an aeroplane, you know what I would do? I would study everything I know about aeroplanes. And studying alone is not good enough, as I illustrated. Better still, go and actually try to work in an aeroplane company to see the inside out. You know the story of how Yamaha got its first piano? Anybody know that story? You know Yamaha, right? The Yamaha musicers, and now they're music, all those things. He went and learned under the European piano makers. Because you cannot learn how to build pianos from a book. How to build your own piano. DIY, you know, do your own piano. You can't. You can build something that has sound with 88 keys, but it's not going to be a good one. He went to learn and watch because there are some things you cannot learn from a book. Too many things that are not described. And so, there's a story, I read that story long, long ago, decades ago in Read Digest, how he learned under these masters. And he watched them, and he has to do with choosing the wood. So detailed. The wood, everything, and then finally when he feels he has mastered the thing, he goes back to Japan and does the same thing. And begin to build and improve. And that Real Digest article written decades ago was a story of the first Yamaha piano. And by the time he produced it to a certain quality, they have a blind test. In the blind test, without knowing what the thing was, it came out as good as the European. How did they do it? They went under great men and great piano makers. Now today we know the best steel and the best sword or knives are made by the Japanese. And you know what skill it is that they take. You want to learn how to do it? Somehow or other, you got to go under them. And that's where, in point number two, part of developing our gift is learning under a similar gift. Which is why Proverbs 18 verse 16 is there. Learning under another gift. Think about that. In Penang, you have the famous Penang Pia. I remembered long, long ago, when you go to Penang, you know the Penang Pia. The first one, you know what it was? Giyang. Ah, Tau Sa Pia, yes. Dragon Ball, they call it. Giyang. The first maker was Giyang. And I know about it because we went to seminary in Penang. My wife is from Penang. Yeah, she's going to be here in 2 weeks' time. And so the Penang Tau Sa Pia, very nice, Giyang. And then, after some time, you know, everyone won. And you got to line up and buy and all those stuff. And we were there in the original days when the first worker broke away. And he started his own. Now, he has learned under Mr. Giyang. Or he Giyang. He learned all the techniques. He's been a worker there. And he come out and he started him Giyang. And through the years, Him Yang developed their own. Him Yang had actually gone beyond Gi Yang. And today, if you go to Penang, there's two famous ones, Gi Yang, Him Yang. Until, of course, 10 years later, another one called Hyang Hyang. But, so, if you go to Penang, there's these two Tau Sa Pia, Gi Hyang, Hing Hyang. Now, you look at here, Hing Hyang developed their own one. They are the one who first started the small little size. Gi Hyang always got the standard size, big one. And then Hing Hyang starts a smaller one, which is just pop in the mouth. And then in the marketing strategy, they call it Dragon Balls. Oh, nice marketing strategy. And today, if I go to Penang, the Hing Hyang actually is nicer than Gi Hyang. It's from Penang. To you, Hing Hyang better, Gi Hyang better. Eh? You see, he likes Hing Hyang. But Gi Hyang was the original. I also actually like Hing Hyang. He has improved on that. So, your gift has to bring you before great men. Excuse those who are from America and Australia who hear this Gi Hyang, Hing Hyang, whatever. What are you talking about, Pastor? Please explain. Sometimes I got emails from my students saying, what are you talking about? Okay. These are all pastry kind of Chinese. What shall we call it? Biscuit. Okay. Delicacies. And so in Penang there's this delicacy, Hing Hyang. Hing Hyang actually is nice. Not bad. And I know in Singapore you have your specialties too. The same. Like somebody, like today I was brought to a place, Sister Christine brought me to a place and we happened to go to different places, and then he says, since we are near here, I bring you to the famous wonton noodle. And there we went. Wow, there was a long line. And then she says, oh, on Sunday, the line is 5 times longer. So you get used to lining up for hawker food in Singapore only. And so she lined up there, and I was watching this person. And then I say, why should this wonton mee be famous? So she said, okay, this person made his own char siu. And it was definitely different. Yes, it was definitely different. And apparently, he got it from his father. And this guy is a university graduate who inherited the wonton business from his father, who learned how to make it the same way. And there was a long line. People just come to eat homemade char siu. So I look at the wonton noodle. I say, hey, the wonton noodle looks different. You know, there are different type of wonton noodle. There's one that's a sticky and one that's like a rubber band one. Rubber band one is more like the Penang. Penang one is like rubber band, right? In the south one is like the sticky glutinous rice type. And so he's a bit like the rubber band one. And sorry, those of you who love wonton noodle, we got to use expression to describe rubber band wonton noodle. And so it was very nice. But I was fascinated by the fact that he didn't invent it. He has to inherit it from his father. The skill of making that wonton noodle. Okay, I know I'm making some of you hungry tonight. But some things you learn from another. And then you learn and you improve it. Look at the Japanese. Today, some of the best cameras are Japanese. But they copy it. The same today. You know, China is doing a lot of copying. Watch and see. 30 years' time, the best might be them. Same with the Koreans. You know, they were not the first to make the flat screen TVs and all the plasma and LCDs, all the memory. But today, everyone knows that the best screens are the Koreans. Now, the Japanese still got theirs, but the standard has definitely dropped. Copy, innovate, improve. But they reverse engineer. Then after reverse engineering, the maximum possible, they invent new things and go further. That's why the second line is important. Mentoring under another one. The great man, that's where the other one comes from. And mentoring opportunities come from God. God Himself. Your gift will make room for you. And because of your gift, what brings you before great men? The second line in chapter 18, verse 16, your gift. Do you think that the master will take any Tom, Dick, and Harry? Of course not. He will take the best of the best of the best. And you got to rise up to be among the best to be selected. But it is not a competition like you see on TV. You know? And you say, Master Chef and Master this, and then they get opportunity. No. This one is ordained and organized by God. Your gift will bring you the open doors you need to bring an opportunity where you will be under great men. Why? Because the great men imply they are the ones who are more gifted than you, more excellent than you, so that you can improve even more. I believe it's no coincidence that Elijah was led to Elisha. And Elisha served for 10 years faithfully. Here's where servanthood comes. A lot of people had no patience. They just want to develop their gift. I got a gift. My gift is better than yours. Even if your gift is better than yours, wait your turn. Wait your turn. David made a better king than King Saul. But he waited his turn. If he hurried, it would have been wrong timing totally. Even if you think you can do better than the one you serve, do not usurp authority. God will not be with you. You wait your turn. You serve faithfully. Let God, let the one before you finish their work graciously. The kingdom of God does not tolerate politics. Politics in the kingdom of God kill both the one who play and the one who is the victim. And only God is left standing. And I've seen it over 30 over years of ministry. And you see wherever people gather, there's politics. Even the business world, there's politics. Anywhere where a group of people, there's politics. It doesn't work that way. You know, people play politics all the time, but in the end, what is meant to be will be meant to be. You cannot stop the gift of God. Because heaven has ordained for some things to happen. Even if the leader makes a mistake, one of the things I learned from our experience in Malaysia is this. When we had our failures in Malaysia, all those fivefold jump in. You know, originally I told the fivefold to take over, I say, look, watch the church for me for 2 years and then I'll come back. Within 1 or 2 weeks, they started taking over the church and making decisions that I look at it and say, I know they're not wanting me to come back. That was when I knew that was their motive. Look at what has happened today. They could not keep the church together. Why? It was not their gift. It split 7 ways. It was not meant to be. They thought they could, but they learned the lesson they cannot. What a hard lesson. And one lesson I learned from that, don't walk away. But when these things happen, all you want to do is walk away. Because I am not someone who loves to play politics. But I'm not the same man like before. I learned. And I have gone through guerrilla warfare. I don't walk away this time, my friends. When I'm challenged, I challenge back. I walk away too many times. In 1981, we helped to start a church called the Word Center. I wanted to keep the church expanding, and then there was 5 people in the board. So I want to make a decision to expand my faith. So there was me and my wife, a businessman and his wife. The businessman has passed away, by the way. He's a good man, but he's passed away. And then another professional, an engineer. 5 of us in the board. We knew how the voting would be. My wife would vote for me. His wife would vote for him. Left the engineer. And so we all look at the engineer. Whose side are you going to be? And the engineer didn't dare to vote. He says he wants to please both sides. And so because he doesn't want to vote, it's still a draw. So he said, okay, let's decide by bringing the next level board in. So the next level board was supposed to vote. That will add probably about 12 votes. And then I spoke to one of my associates whom I groomed up and trained. He was a nobody. I personally brought him from Penang to KL. Took care of him. Gave him a room, salary, sponsored, everything. And then I spoke to him and said, look, I expect you to back me up in this major decision for the church. And I was on the phone, and the first thing I heard was that he was going to go on the other side. I walk away. I say, I'm not going to play this. And I say, look, if you're going to start doing that and people canvassing votes, I say, no way. So I walk away. And then we started TOG. So we grew and grew. So that's why they can take the church from you, but if you're called to build the church will still appear. They can take the ministry from you, but if your gift is the ministry will still appear. They can take the business from you, but if you are a God-ordained businessman, the business will still come. Remember what in the business world, let's talk stories from the business world. Remember what they did to Steve Jobs? Remember how they kicked him out for Apple? And Apple nearly died. And when they kicked him out, an inventor. When he went out, he started, I think, the next computer, NEXT, that was the brand. He got a whole operating system, he started the whole thing. It was not fully successful, but Apple needed him. But all his work in that system was brought into the new Apple. It was of some use still. And look at where he took Apple computers today. Because that was his gift. I didn't say that it was a perfect gift. Now, they might reach a point where they become proud. Their thinking box stopped working. You know, when pride comes, thinking box stopped working. Because it gets stuck. You know, you thought you're the king of the world. It's like King Nebuchadnezzar. He looked at his hanging garden. Isn't this the great Babylon whom I build? The watcher up there says, now you shall be humble. Because when we think we have done all, we forgot one thing. It is all a gift from God. At the end of the day, no matter how greatly God uses, let's all remember to go back to our room, bow down on our knees and say, thank you, God, you gave me this life. At any time right now, God could take any one of your life and you will die. If He so chooses. You're one breath away from dying. One breath away. Because all I have to do is hold your breath and don't let you breathe and you will die. You're one breath away from dying. So when we think we are great, we are not. When you think you're mighty, you are not. You are not. It's important for us to know that. Which is why we need to be humble enough to allow God to open the doors before great men. I like the way the Bible is great men or before kings. You know why? No matter how clever you are, how smart you are, how talented you are, how gifted you are, there's always someone more gifted than you. Think of it. There's always someone more gifted than you. The someone more gifted than you, someone more talented than you, might not be in the same position as you are, might not be the same power as you, might not be as rich as you, but there is always someone more gifted than you, more talented than you, whom God might put you under for a season so that you could sharpen your gift in Him. It's important for us to know that. And these are opportunities that we should treasure. We should treasure. Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, three friends of Daniel. You know why they are blessed? They are blessed as long as they support Daniel. You cannot have more than one Red Indian chief in any place. Sometimes people say, I'm the Red Indian chief, I'm supposed to be in charge. If they are in charge, everybody runs. You know, when people feel they should be in charge, that's when they should not be in charge. You know, when someone says, I don't know, I'm not sure, you know, I really need God, I'm not sure you can do, that's the person who God will use. Because that is the person who will be humble enough to allow others to come up. Jesus said, don't do like the Gentiles. Remember that. The Gentiles system is an oppressive system. They step over one another's head. They don't mind crushing the person under them to step ahead. And everyone, they're oppressing all the time. Make sure they don't come out. And anyone is just like Survivor on TV. You know, they plot, they run, you know. And you know the person they vote out is the could be a good person. But because that person is going to be your enemy number one, get rid of him now. So chop off all those things so that you could reign as king. When God didn't establish you as king and you try all those things, you're no better than King Saul, who plotted to get rid of David because David was a better man than him. Guess what? You can never get rid of what God has ordained. Because there was a gift, an anointing of God that was there. No matter how he tried. Even his own son, Jonathan, who was supposed to be the heir of the kingdom, recognized and said, David, when you are king, I will be next to you. He was willing to abdicate the throne. Can you imagine? Abdicate the throne. The father scolded him. Why are you so foolish, this son? As long as David lives, you cannot be king. That was what the father told him. He said, forget about you. Because the anointing of God was on David. The only mistake Jonathan should have done, he should have left the father long ago. And joined David's army, he would have been alive. He would have been alive. There are a few people in the Bible who have been alive. Among them was Jehoshaphat. Do you know how good King Jehoshaphat died? Because he was the brother-in-law to the bad king. Joined him in battle, got killed. That's why sometimes God says, leave your family. Because you got to choose between that. No. Of course, we're not talking about breaking up your family. We're talking about how sometimes if a family is not walking with God, you still got to keep walking with God to pull all of them up. Keep your family together, but keep pulling all of them up together. And your uncle, auntie are all behaving like the devil. You know, just keep walking with God still. Keep walking with God. It's important. There are good men who have died because they joined forces wrongly. And one of the things I like about King David's mighty men is this. They knew that as long as they were with David, they had a place in life. The moment David was gone, they would be disunited as an army. And it took David to unite. And these are not things we all choose. Remember the apostles? When Jesus was about to go to the cross, you know what they were fighting? I want to sit at the right hand. No, I want to sit. Everybody was after the right hand. Funny, nobody wanted to sit in the left hand, which was close enough to, you know. Actually, not bad. No? You see, your right hand, you know. You say, okay, somebody chose the right hand. At least I'm... the next one, the left side, can be very close. Anybody in the right hand, you know, things in the position. And you know what Jesus answered them? These are chosen by the Father even before we were born. So why quarrel about something that we never chose and never could choose, never would have the opportunity to choose? Forget about those things. But let's choose areas we can choose that can affect our lives. And we do all have a free choice. to learn this. And one of the things I've learned is learn from every ministry possible. Which is why my house is full of books. Sometimes, you know, you don't have opportunity to sit under those ministries, but you can study under those ministries. And you study and learn the best you can. And then you have all those things, and then you go forth from there. And it doesn't matter. Sometimes people don't even want to give credit, you know, and say, oh, you know, those things have been. Doesn't matter, because you know why? The credit system is not on earth. And the earth credit system doesn't really work well, and it's never fair. Heaven's credit system. So that if you are where you are because of somebody else who have paid the price for you, opened the door for you, prayed for you, saw you through, nursed you through, nurtured you through, and then you stood tall and mighty and rule as a king in business or king in ministry, and you tell everybody in your testimony, you catch up all those people, remove about 300 of them. And your story was, you made it on your own. And you publish your biography. That's your biography. Oh, wow. Everybody say, wow, rags to riches story, all on your own. And in heaven, the book looks different. Heaven, when you go to heaven, you say, wow, all these 300 people, say, who are those 300 people? On the day you receive your reward, you know, one day we all be rewarded in heaven. When God calls for the reward, and as the reward is coming, and then your turn comes for the reward, and you're looking, whoa, the high and mighty. You know, you say, I wonder whether Jesus read my biography. You're like, high and mighty. And then instead of calling you, Jesus called the 300 who were nurturing you. And all their reward is crowns upon crowns and then ground. And then finally come to your turn. So you say, okay, now you can come out. You who asked me to read your biography. Here's your little crown. See, why so crown? It's so small that if you put it on top, it looks like a dune's hat. Because that's all you deserve. And they say, why, Lord? And the Lord will tell you these things. You have received all your reward on earth. While these 300 never received their reward. So now they have their reward. And you really enjoy your reward, so no more, only this one left. So heaven's story is different. I can assure you, every one of us have been molded by people we like and people we don't like. Yeah, there's some people you don't like who have been placed there to mold your life. And you are who you are because of them. Iron sharpens iron. And so this life doesn't consist of just gathering people you like. Because sometimes God put you right next door to someone you don't like, or place you to work with someone you just find it hard, who rubs you the wrong way all the time so that more love can come out. Yet it's God who places it in your life. And God molds us for your gift to grow stronger. And I remember in the early days of my ministry, God has placed me and this particular accountant who helped together. Although we have differences, I appreciate it. Today he's in heaven. He died early when I was suddenly, just like that too. I don't know why. And he was one of those guys who challenged everything I believe. We used to sit for long nights to talk about doctrine. And I came out of it much stronger, that kind of relationship. And it challenged everything I believe. And they were extremes, but they were part of the formative years. So some people you like, some people you don't quite like, but God placed them in your life for a reason. And God placed your husband and wife where you are. Some of you are thinking, oh, must I marry the wrong person? No, God chose them. Before you were born, God knows how to mold you. And some of you who are single, you know, and your closest friend or the people you're with, and let me tell you, Singapore is a small place. You know, you can go from one church to another easily. Say, oh, I don't like this person, go to the next one. Guess what? In the other church, you meet another person exactly like the person you ran from. Exactly. And you run from the second church, just wait a while. You'll find a third person also the same. Until you learn the lesson that this is the type of person that God wants to mold you with, be with. In the end, just be where God wants you to be. Every church has its destiny. Serve in whatever church you want to function in. But remember, your gift makes room for you. In the business world, unfortunately, you might have to even learn from unbelievers who are more skillful than you. Have an open mind. Remember this, every good gift came from God. Even if those people don't know God yet, learn from all that you can. And then because you have God and you have relationship with God, you can even do better. And go one step better. The thing that should make us more passionate is this. We should, with God, be able to do better. Where are the Daniels of this life to rise up higher? Because they know. 10 times wiser than the astrologers and the magicians. Much better. Where are the people who know God to rise up? Where are the Davids who dare to rise up against a Goliath because they say that they are uncovenanted people while we have a covenant with God? Where are they? They are in our midst. Need to encourage them to develop the gifting of God, but must not be proud. Learn from those before us. We have to learn from those before us. Learn all their skills. Who were Daniel's teachers? You think they were Christians or Jewish? No. You know, all his teachers in the Babylonian school were pagans. Did Daniel have to learn from them? Yes, you had to learn the literature of Babylon. He had to learn astronomy. And in those days, the astrology was more like astronomy type. And they had to learn all these things under pagan teachers. Did Daniel just sit down and say, all the devil. So in class, he just draw doodles. No, he was absorbing everything, questioning everything, rejecting the wrong thing, understanding everything, analyzing everything. And by the time the king asked him mathematics, astronomy, everything, he could answer better than them. Because he thought through everything and then he understood everything. And he got his own understanding from God too, and he could see better than anyone else. So yes, sometimes if you're called to the secular world, professional world, you have to learn from where they are. You can be the best economist, you can be the best whatever God asks you to be, an engineer, because unfortunately some of those skills, the body of Christ did not rise up to take those skills. Or the best painter, or the best business person, best computer person, whatever. You learn those skills and then you have God to add on to your skill 10 times better and you can advance. Your gift will bring you before those. So, faithful in little, faithful in much. Number two, the attitude, as I mentioned, of a servant. Unless you're willing to learn, God will not give you those opportunities. So, when your gift makes you proud, you don't want to learn from anybody else. But if your gift keeps you humble, and I'm still learning, even where I am, I believe we'll keep learning all our life. We keep learning all our life. There's still so much to know of God, so much to learn from God. I'm still like a sponge thirsting after knowledge, a quest to know more, a quest to understand. I'm still thirsting after the things of God. And we want to learn as much as we can. And that attitude can only come when we have a servant heart. We're willing to sit down and learn from everyone and every person God gave and place in your path. Your gift makes room for you. So faithful in little, faithful in much. Your gift brings you before great people. And that means that you got to learn from where everyone is, like a servant heart. Learn from everyone else and then you excel. The Bible says in Daniel chapter 6, I believe around verse 3, Daniel distinguished himself from everybody else because he had an excellent spirit. In Daniel 6, he distinguished, he made a difference between them and him because he got an excellent spirit. The word excellent, the spirit is just a normal word, ruach. Excellent is from the Hebrew word yater, Y-A-T-T-I-Y-R. Yater, which means to surpass or excel. So to surpass or excel, you must learn everything for that person before you surpass. And do you know why Paul was Paul in the New Testament? He gave you a clue in Galatians chapter 1 and chapter 2. He says, I excel above my contemporaries. So that the spirit that carries you beyond everybody else. But to be beyond, you must learn under first. You learn everything that needs to be learned. You learn from the masters. You learn from the great ones. You learn from those before you. In my formative years in the ministry, I learned. Absorb everything I can from every man and woman of God. I still have the heroes of faith in that I consider. And of course, Jesus is my prime mentor that I want to learn from. You learn and then you want to surpass all the men and women of God. And we should. Because the last day church is without spot and wrinkle. We can go beyond. We must have the excellent spirit, which is number one, be faithful in little thing and build it to much. Number two, have a servant heart. Teachability, being willing to learn from others. And sometimes even from those who are gifted in their own area. And you're listening as well. And you can tell when you're with people and people are fellowshipping, sometimes you can learn things from everybody. Even from a person who is new in the things of God, but they have a different area that God gave to them. And I love to hear and to learn from all the different things that God has been giving. It's important for us. We can be assured that balanced prosperity involves who we are, not just what we do. I mean, what we do comes from who we are. You don't have a worry in the world. Whether you're in the ministry, you're in the professional life, you're in the business world, you just keep doing those things that are in your talent and gift. Why I mention talent? Because not every one of us have discovered our spiritual gift yet. But every one of us have talents. So you start with the talents wherever you are. And keep flowing and building. And how do you know if those things are the talents God gave? You're a happy person when you do those talents. And you know, because it's synchronized within you. Like if you're not a mathematician, I give you maths book, you say, ah. But you're a mathematician, you love maths, I give it to you, wow, you'll be enjoying yourself. So something within you tells you. In the pursuit of the happiness that you have. In the end, our goal is love, joy, peace, happiness. That's what we want. Whether you have much or you have little, these are the most precious things. It's more important to live and die a happy man, a happy woman, knowing that you have been a happy person. Than to live 120 years filthy, rich, unhappy, depressed, suppressed, oppressed. So much better to have known that you have lived a life full of love. Isn't that wonderful? Imagine on your deathbed. You're sorry about talking about deathbed. And you're going to, about to go home and you know you're going to go home. You say, ah, what a loving life you had. Ah, what a peaceful life you had. Ah, what a joyful life you had. Because by that time, money doesn't count. And it actually doesn't count. Because a lot of people are happy with half the money that some other people have. Love, joy, and peace. The good thing is, as you do those things and you love God and God loves you, because God wants you to be a blessing, God does increase the natural blessing too. The prosperity does come so that you can be a bigger blessing to people. That's all God wants us to be. Just to be a happy person in Him. Love, joy, peace. The happy Christian life is what we all want to do. Praise God. We don't have to try to be in the ministry God never called you. Don't try to be business world God never called you. Don't try to be anything that God doesn't call you. Find your gift. Blessed are those who find their gift. For they shall be happy in their life. They shall live happy, die happy, go happy in heaven. The happiest Christian on earth. Let's pray. Father, we pray that you will establish us, Lord, in your gift. We thank you, Lord, that in this world of striving and trying, in this society where people push themselves so hard that sometimes they hurt themselves and they hurt others, in a world, oh God, where people are in a rat race, where they bite one another, they kill one another, they destroy one another to get ahead. We don't want to join the rat race, Lord. We don't want to be like the Gentiles. We don't want to be like the people of the world. We just want to do your will. To be a happy Christian. To be a happy minister. A happy businessman. A happy professional. A happy housewife, a happy husband, a happy person, Lord. Full of love, joy, and peace in what you want us to do. So, Father, we pray right now, Lord, that you help each one of us to discover the innermost and the most integral talent and gift within us of who you made us to be. What you make us to be. Father God, we pray, God, that you reveal this in our life. You reveal this, Lord, and express it through us. Thank you, Father, that you cause us to discover all that we are, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all rise together. Is there any song that say, all that I am? Oh, let's have that one then. Yes. Can you lead that one? Thank you. Part of his plan. Because there's such a thing as predestination. It was predestined that Joseph would make those mistakes he made, anger his brothers, and end up in Egypt. Mistakes are made by every single human being on earth. But because you love God and because God loves you, He has predestined even the mistakes to be a part of our walk in life. And when other people make mistakes, and you are among those who watch those mistakes, you were predestined to act or react correctly or incorrectly. By acting incorrectly, you got out of God's will. By acting correctly, you become a part of God's will. God will never condemn your mistakes. And this call is for you. You could be like the woman at the well who has five husbands and the one you live is not your husband. God doesn't care. He only cares that you start walking with Him wherever you are. And when you look back at your life one day, now you look back, and when you go to heaven and you look back, no matter how painful, how shameful, how horrible, you will discover it was your destiny to walk through that. Strange, but true. We are all responsible for our mistakes. But when you choose to come into this body, into this life, to be born of the family you were born with, to be brought up in the circumstances you were brought with, and let me tell you, anyone else living the same life will make the same mistakes. Anyone having the same opportunities with the same personality would have made the same mistakes. So no one can judge you except God. And the call is this: never give up. If you are here and you're in a situation where you want to give up, I'd like you to come to the front as we say, we're going to pray for you. If you feel that you are out of God's will right now, I want you to know you are not. As long as you love God and God loves you, somewhere in your heart, all things will work out for good to those who love Him. So you come and we will pray for you.
Things in the past, things
that I am. In the past,
I lay them down before you, my Lord. All my regrets and all my acclaim.
The joy and the pain, no matter how much pain you have, it is part of your destiny. To understand that God knows all things.
I offer my Lord, I offer my life to you, everything I've been through. Use it for your glory, Lord. I offer my days to you, lifting my praise to you as a pleasing sacrifice.
In the past,
things in the past yet unseen, things yet unseen, wishes and dreams that are yet to come true. All of my hopes, all of my plans, my heart and my to you, Lord, I offer my life to you, everything I've been through.
place that you've been through, my sister in the Lord. The Lord knows the path of pain and heartache that you've gone through. The Lord wants you to know that all the while He has never left you. Though you left Him, He has never left you. He has always been there. He will always be there. Just as He is here for you tonight. To draw you into His presence. Because though all may give up on you, He never gave up on you. And I understand precisely what it means. Because I've been through that road. One of the things the Lord spoke to me, He brought me into the heaven, He says, if you did not and you were not humble, and I use you, people will say it's your ability. But I've taken you through the path, I've taken you, the Lord told me, so that when my glory is on you and all these things that I show you of the creative miracle starts taking place, they will know it's not by might, not by power. By the grace that I place upon your life. Same for you. But the Lord says, He has a great work for you to do. He has great plans for you. And today His anointing is on your life. Right now. His presence is filling you right now. Touching your heart and life. Thank you, Father. Touch her. Feel her, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let your grace and power be upon this life. In Jesus' name. Amen. There it goes. Right. Thank you, Jesus. His calm, peace, and assurance coming upon you. He has a plan for you. A plan that you know in your heart, that He used the humble, and you will be used in mighty ways in prayer, in your call, in the ministry and love that you have for people, and God will do mighty works through. It is only the beginning, saith the Lord. Only the beginning. And it's a pathway full of His glory that He bring your family through. Because His healing anointing is on your hands. And His grace is upon you. And you will see the day will come when miracles, signs and wonders pour upon the body of Christ in this great revival, and you will have your portion to do, to fulfill. Thank you, Lord. Grace in your power. It is His plan that's taken you through the winding path, so that when you walk the straight path, you will know how straight it is. The ways of the Lord are straight before you. There goes His anointing on your life. Thank you, Jesus. He has given you many friends to stand with you, to establish you, so that you know when the presence of God comes, it is not just you, but His presence will come such a manner that you know you have been built and been ready and prepared for His presence. Fellowship with those that the Lord brings into you, and He will cause your path to always be filled with His good friends who will strengthen you, be around you, to establish the ways of the Lord in your life. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. In the past, things that I'm seeing, we
wishes and dreams that are yet to come true. All of my hopes, all of my plans, my heart and my hands are lifted to you.
Here in this place tonight will continue upon you. It is a time of revival, and you are sensing the closeness of this revival. It will be a time when the presence of the Lord come and we will bow and be broken before Him. For He breaks us so that we are broken in His sight, that His Spirit can work through us to receive all the glory. And it will be a powerful glory that He'll bring. So let's continue in this presence and walk in His presence and love. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.